visual yourself and see what's going on and why we do what we do. A lot of it is, you know, patience building and all of that, but we also have to realize that, you know, the soil, this actually you can Google, soil actually increases your serotonin, so it's good for your body health, which is awesome. Dirt under your fingernails improves your gut health, which I thought was interesting. Gardening reduces some symptoms of ADHD, which is kind of fun. But these are just kind of fun facts that as you go through, and I found them and I was like, wow, that's kind of a cool thing to have up while everybody's getting settled. So we're going to talk a little bit about Wildflowers Texas style. I moved to Texas 30 years ago. My father-in-law at the time, I said to him, I said, so when did the bluebonnet come out? April Fool's Day, always. And I'm like, okay. So anything about 2 weeks before April Fool's Day and into April is when your bluebonnets are going to come up. The thing that you need to remember is you can't just have bluebonnets immediately. They are definitely a patience builder, and you have to start thinking about them around Halloween time. October is your time for that. So we'll get into it a little bit different. Thank you very much for the Ag Center for allowing us to do these lunch and learns and expand all of our knowledge, whether we're novice or we are experienced master gardeners. It's an amazing venture. So keep them in mind. Housekeeping, real quick. Make sure that you fill out the questionnaire at the beginning and then fill it out at the end. How much did you come in with and how much are you taking home with you? Second, make sure your phones are on silent. That's a personal and a very egotistical thing. It just helps me stay focused because that ADHD that I'm working on in the garden gets me distracted. Jot down any of your questions so that we can continue with the presentation. Hopefully the questions will be answered in the presentation, but if it's not, we can answer them at the end. And that just helps us do that. And most important, take what you want, leave the rest. I'm gonna give you my experiences over the last year and a half with Wildflowers and what I've learned. And then I always appreciate anything that you have to give me as well. So that's kind of how I work in my world. So here we go. So a few things that we're going to learn. We're gonna learn obviously, we're going to learn about, can you just throw them down and forget about them? We're going to talk about site and location and planning on those. We're going to talk about your journaling and what needs to happen. Do you need to water and feed wildflowers? How does that work? To make them more beautiful or not? Planting, we're going to talk a little bit about the zone and the landscape. So many people come to visit Texas and they take the bluebonnets home and they're like, oh, I want bluebonnets in my garden. And they get to Michigan and it doesn't work and they wonder why. And so we're going to talk a little bit about zone. I don't know how many of you know your prostate that's coming up. Anybody? November 17th-ish. Right there in the middle of November is what it's anticipated, but with all the crazy weather, who knows? And the containers. Do you want to plant your bluebonnets or your wildflowers in containers? It's one of those things that, depending on the space that you have available, because we all don't have these beautiful fields that we can just throw them up there and make it grow. So this was my my bluebonnet venture last year in my backyard. I planted them in the middle of October, and they came up amazing. So I'm pretty proud of that. That's my commute. You'll hear about my commute as things go. So why do we plant wildflowers? One of the amazing reasons we plant our wildflowers is for the simple reason that we want pollinators in our yard. We want to see the monarchs. We want to see the butterflies and the bees and everybody that has a job, whether we like them or not, has a job in the forest, in the wildflower garden. So these, I'm going to tell you, so my irises look really pretty good. Those are actually from the Big Red Barn. I propagated those. So again, we need to plant our wildflowers or flowers in the garden, pollinators, whatever that looks like. There's so much development, as we all know, that a lot of the natural wildflowers that are out there are not producing. They're just not allowing to do what they need to do. And so by planting our own pollinators in our garden, it helps our facilities, but it also brings back the bumblebees right now. I have a dear friend that has, he harvests and does bees and honey. And he was saying how they're becoming extinct. And, you know, I mean, we think, God, there's so many out there, but we really need to keep that population growing. And the monarchs, too. It takes four generations to get from the north to Mexico City on their vacation in order to pass through. So we need to keep those things going. So they are pollinator friendly. And this is a little bit difficult to read here, but if you did download my presentation, you'll see all of the wildflowers. And this is actually from Ms. Johnson's wildflower garden. So take a look at those. Decide what you want to look at when your wildflowers come up. Because not everybody likes every wildflower that's out there. And you might be doing a specific color in your garden. So take a look at what's easy and do your research on a specific one. One that we were talking about for the class started is your butterfly milkweed. At least put three or four of those in there. That deflects a lot of the butterflies from eating all of the other flowers that you have in there that you want to see. So they'll eat the milkweed and they're like, eh, okay, fine, whatever. And then about 3 months later, you have another batch of wildflowers. All right, so we're going to go through, obviously we talked about the butterflies, and if you have been anywhere near the flowers in the garden, anybody that you're seeing is any of my sea of mine, they are amazing to watch, and they aren't scared. You can get out there and get real close and watch, and it's that you, there's some Indian blanket. The nice thing about wildflowers is they are definitely liking poor soil. They don't have to have all of the nutrients and everything that you put in your raised flower bed. Excuse me. You can have a poor soil health. They have root systems that stabilize and go for water when you don't have any water to give. So that's one of the good reasons about putting it in your yard, especially with all of the drought situations that we've had most recently. So the idea of the poor soil, now I'm not saying that it's really bad where nothing grows. You do have to get out there, break the soil down to have it level so that when you put your seeds down that you're going to be able to have the soil contact with your seeds. And then planting wildflowers obviously is a tradition in Texas. Everybody wants them, everybody wants to try to do them, but they don't realize what they are. They are, most of them are animals. They are not perennials. Even though they come up in the same place every year, they are not perennials. You have to have the seeds to have that happen. So as the wildflowers bloom, as beautiful as they are right now, So one of the things that you can do that is kind of exciting, if you don't have this, the wildflower brochure, it actually has a location of all the wildflowers that are throughout Texas, and it will give you a map so that during wildflower season, you can actually go see them in different locations. And that's put on by TxDOT. They do some things good. All right. And as you're out in the wildflower world, we have to realize that weeds sometimes are also good for the pollinating, and they're actually wildflowers. So when you see a dandelion, depending on where it is in your yard, if you're out there like me with my cup of coffee in the morning pulling every last one of them out of my grass, that's one thing. You will have people in your homeowners association that will cut their grass, and they will tell you that they're not cutting them because they're promoting the pollinators by keeping all of those dandelions blooming, which is a good thing in some respects. But remember that when you keep those dandelions blooming, the minute they go to seed and they get to be those beautiful little wish givers that they are, they will be in your yard. It is legend that once you have them go away, it's 7 years of dandelions that you'll have in your yard. So keep that in mind. But I actually have people in my neighborhood that have said that they're not cutting their yard because they're producing pollinating helpers. All right, let's talk a little bit. We're going to go through some blue bonnets. I will not be doing the scientific names, only because I can't pronounce them correctly and I don't want to come off. So as we go, so this is the Texas blue bonnet. They get to be 18 inches tall on a good day. Sometimes they're just little. They are the most beautiful flower I think I've ever watched and watched from beginning to end. I have to give credit to Miss Ann, because I was out at the Marion Garden at the beginning, and she was helping me determine what was a weed and what was not. And then if you do pull up a blue bonnet by accident, all you do is put it back in and you can cover it up and hope and pray. But the blue bonnets are amazing. They are, this is the perfect time of year to be planting the blue bonnets. So the month of October is when you want to grab your seeds and go. Wildflower farm, obviously everybody knows about. But one that I have discovered and I found out that they're real close and you don't have to have them sent to your house is native Texan seeds. They are located off of 35 and 1103. And you can actually go over and pick up your seeds. You can order them, pick them up, and they'll have them all there.
Is that bulk?
They do. They have the big, these are the little bags, but they go in the big bags of acreage and acreage and acreage if you want to do it. And they have the grasses and all of the, anything that is native, they have there. It's just a little tiny store. It's kind of funny because it's next to the turf grass. Don't quite understand it, but all right. But they're right there on the corner, and you can go in and pick up your seeds. So you don't have to have them sent to the house. It's kind of good. But anyway, so the blue bonnets are my favorite. That's where I started last year. I went ahead and I took blue bonnets, and I just put them all up against my canoe. And I said, okay, it's your turn. Take over. And they sure did. Very fun. All right. Oh, the other thing about blue bonnets, though, real quick. There are people out there that will tell you to scuff them. To scuff them. To put there are people that will tell you, put them on the concrete, and rub them on the concrete, and scuff them, and then plant them. I believe in God's way. God takes them off of the plant and throws them onto the dirt, and they just do their thing. So it's kind of up to you. I haven't tried the scuffing thing. I guess I'm too lazy to pick it up off of the driveway once I scuff them. So. Cave and Refresh is another one that's really beautiful out there. And when I first moved to Texas, I became part of the Storytellers Association in San Antonio. And I got to hear my first Indian folklore of bluebonnets and paintbrushes. And so there are books out there that will give you the folklore on those wonderful stories of all the wildflowers of Texas and how the Indian culture is done there too. Those Indian paintbrushes. Indian blankets. These are amazing. And sometimes they come up pretty, and sometimes they're not. But God does come with each and every one of them. And they're also 18 to 24 inches tall. So we're talking 2 feet that will stand up out of your garden. So kind of beware of where you're planting your wildflowers, because they get a lot bigger than just being a small garden cover. So as you do this, make sure before you put those seeds down, once you put them down and they're so tiny, you're going to watch where they're going to be to spray them if they're going to do that. The nice part about these is bloom late spring. So you'll have your bluebonnets come up, your bluebonnets will go down, and then your Indian blankets will come up. So you can actually have a lot of flowers all summer, from spring to fall, if you plant correctly. So that's kind of a fun one too.
Karen?
Yes.
There's a little kind of a ball. Does it involve?
Is that a bud or is that a seed?
No, I think this is not this. I think
I'm with you.
Yes,
I said that. Predicting rain, so then you see them the way it will come up.
they'll plant them for you. And I ended up having a big bushel of this in the back, and I had no idea it was even going to be planted. So, and they're beautiful. The purple is just gorgeous. They are so tolerant of no water, and just everything about the wildflowers, verbena especially, they don't care. They don't want you. They don't want to have anything to do with you. They're going to do their thing. And they spread very well if you have a good batch of them. Black-eyed Susans, another one that's real pretty, real tolerant of all of our heat, and they show up like ready to go tomorrow. And then amazing sunflowers that grow 6 feet and taller. I have a neighbor that did a wildflower little bed right by my fence line, right by my wildflowers, and so I get the benefit of seeing hers coming up and over the fence on that. And the thing that you'll notice about these also is that our birds will go ahead and grab the seeds, and they will plant them where they want them to be planted in your yard too. So if you put them in one corner and you expect them to stay there, and you have all the birds coming in, just know that you might have them in other places in your yard that you may not want them. All right. So again, benefits to planting the wildflowers, especially during this drought that we've been having, it's low maintenance. You put them out there and let them do their thing. Low water. You don't have to water them anymore than you do the grass. So if you put them in an area where you have your sprinkler system set up, just let it go with that. And then, of course, to do it with the pattern, not only the bluebonnets, but the rest of the wildflowers, you're going to have a rolling garden all summer long. Makes a world of difference. So this is the most important thing that I can tell you about the experience of doing the wildflowers, is writing everything down. Journal, journal, journal. So there is, I'm going to just go through this real quick and put it up there, because there are all these things that you need to pay attention to when you're doing your journaling. The Ag Center group trying to figure out when and where we can get these. I picked one of these up. It actually is a journal per year, and it goes through all of these things. So the to-do list, what do I need to do in my wildflower garden January, February, March, it goes through the whole year. Year-end summary, summer up your year, what went well, what didn't, what do I want to do next year, what produced well. If you do a cutting flowers, then harvest log, what did I harvest, when did I harvest, when did I plant. Pests and disease problems, anything that comes across with that. Transplants, if you do transplants, you can go to some of the nurseries and pick up new bonnets. Do transplants work better than my seeding process? What does that look like? Seeds that you planted, fertilizer, if you fertilize, a garden planter. All of those things are going to be really super helpful for you as you journal on for your next year and what was beneficial. I can't tell you how much I have taken nothing more than the journaling aspect. And if you don't want to just go ahead and write a journal, because some of us aren't writers and we don't want to just have this out all the time, if you have a kitchen calendar, make sure that you put down when you seed it so that you can anticipate in 75 days you should be seeing some sort of bluebonnet happening or some sort of flower happening. Oh. So when and where to plant. Here we go. You ready? So 50 to 75 days out for germination of wildflowers. So 75 days, that's a little over 3.5 months. So 3.5 months from now is when we want to see those flowers coming up in our garden. So October. Think autumn equinox, the solstice, as we go through. All of those things. So the month of October, from now until really the 1st of November, you want to get those seeds on the ground, in the water, get them based. And the reason you want that is because they need to develop their roots during the cold season. It's not about the top part, it's not about the stuff that's coming out of the ground, it's about where their bases are going. You want them really established before we get that frost, and before we go ahead and we get the, and we can't water them. Okay? So at the beginning, location, 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 because we're going into the autumn equinox, the solstice, where those days are shorter, you want the place that's going to get the most sun. So we go from, 10 hours of sun a day, and now we're going into 6 and 8 hours, and it's getting shorter and shorter. So you want to make sure that wherever you plant your wildflowers is where you're going to go ahead and have the most sun available so that it can get as many nutrients as it possibly can. And then, of course, a well-drained area. You don't want your wildflowers to be sitting in a lot of water. So when you water for the first, and we'll go into this in a minute, when you water, you want to make sure that it soaks in and doesn't sit. You don't want to drown your seeds. So we go into, there is your timing. You can actually plant through December, but because our frost date is in the middle of November, that might affect your watering cycle. So think Halloween, school time, beginnings. I like to think of it as school. So September is the beginning of school. It's the beginning of thinking about things to come in the spring and the summer. Thinking about graduation, right? We don't plan for graduation the last 2 days. We plan for graduation all year long. So think beginning of school. October is best success for a March and April blooms. Again, choose your location and no competition. No competition. We think that we can take those seeds and we can plant them in a grassy knoll and let it go. Bluebonnets and wildflowers do not like competition. So if you're thinking that you have a grass area that you would like to see bluebonnets in the fall or in the spring, don't just plant them there. You're going to have to pull that grass up or at least cut it down to the bare roots when you plant your bluebonnets or your wildflowers. They don't like competition. They don't want to fight for attention. They want to be the only thing out there. All right, so we go into, can we just throw them down? No, we cannot. We have to prep them somewhat. So, like I said, I went and I bought my seeds. Did the research on the seeds, make sure that this is what I want to do, because once I put it in, there's no taking it back. Those little seeds are so tiny, and you don't want to put them out in the wind. Learned that the hard way. So I made sure to do, so this is what's going to be in my garden, hopefully in the springtime, it'll be a lot of fun. I went out and I got cheap potting soil, just to add some extra nutrients to the ground that I had there, because what I had in this location, I had frog fruit all season, which is amazing if you ever need a ground cover, it's a crazy thing. It likes to collect. There is nothing to that. I went and I got just enough soil to cover the top of my soil. And then I wetted it down. And this was as of 3 days ago. Look at my little ones. They're starting to come up. So it took probably about a week and a half that I did it. And I honestly, thank you guys, because you guys were my motivation for getting this done. So it's been, so I went out there with all the bags, put the bags out, raked it so that it was flat land. Then I went out and literally just spread my seeds all the way across. I know.
I get it.
Well, and you know, I can say that, I can get all excited about this. I said this to my parents, and my parents are like, okay, here, go ahead.
So Karen,
yes.
I've watered those.
smaller amounts, two, three times a week.
So at the beginning, for the first 3 or 4 days, I get out there and sprinkle it enough so that it's wet. I don't overwater and then let it soak in. Now I am on my sprinkler system, which is 2 times a week.
Okay, and my next question is, out in the middle of the field, and we haven't had rain, I'm sure it's since September 1st, but if you have water, we have dew on it, see, it's popping up. But what happens if there are dry years that they're what, delayed?
It depends on
the rain.
Yeah.
If the rain is late, they're just delayed.
They're delayed, or they don't. They just don't. Depending on where you're going to put it, if it's a field that you have access, then you can put a sprinkler out there and you know. But everything that I've read about the bluebonnets, it's God's will.
Question?
Yes.
Is it true that bluebonnets put out seeds that some will germinate 1 year and some another and some has to put out 5 years?
Yeah.
So
they, the bluebonnets, the whole thing with the seeds is I reseed. I don't know what's going to come up from what I had left out there originally because I had the frog fruit over it and everything else. But the bluebonnets, they, that's why, so when you, they talk about scuffing them to make them germinate out of the bags, but God does that automatically, or the divine does that automatically, whatever you believe. But over 5 years, they say that the bluebonnet seeds will sit there, and when they are ready to come to fruit, they will come to fruit. So keep that in mind. So just because you put the bluebonnets up and you don't want them anymore, that doesn't mean that you won't have one or two that'll pop up automatically.
And it can be like up to 5 years, right? Because we, I'm trying to establish, right? And so finding like, okay, fine, you're not going to grow here, and then this past year, you know, so they do, it's like I guess they sit dormant or until they break down, like they're talking
yeah.
about.
They just break and crack as much as they need to crack when they need to crack. I have a little lady that's around the corner from me, and she's a Comal Master Gardener, and she has a rock, literally, her front yard is a rock bed. There is nothing there all season, all year long. And then bluebonnets, this last year, took over the whole rock bed. It went from the front yard all the way to the street. And I was laughing because I saw gardening has done nothing but make me knock on people's doors. but I literally stopped and I said, this is what I want in my backyard. How can you do that? I didn't. You know, she planted it in the area that she wanted it, and they just have gone absolutely amazing, crazy. So yeah, but it is up to 5 years is what they're saying, that they'll be there, that they're around. Yeah, so when you decide you want wildflowers, just think that you want them for a while. They've got their own thing. Again, the bluebonnets like the bad soil. They over time, they will sow themselves. You won't even have to mess with it. You decide what you want to do, cut them down. It's all ugly and you can't stand it anymore, and let them do their thing and go into the soil and they'll come back. They definitely love those things. They need full sun. That's the best. There is, matter of fact, Native Texas has a shade wildflower mix. If you want to try it, I have not tried it. I don't know any wildflowers that really do the shade mix, but it's worth a shot. Let's see. Bluebonnets, again, don't like competition. They don't want to fight with anybody for their space. And bluebonnets are early bloomers, and they actually do their best when they're not crowded out by other plants. So your blue bonnets and your wildflower planting in the back of your yard where you have maybe a lot of space, make sure that you level it out, put a little topsoil on the side if it's decent soil, and go out there and you get yourself your little fertilizer and put a little sand with your seeds, and you can walk your yard wherever you want it. If you have that much space, I wish I had that much space. But the rainfall is usually adequate. You're going to need to water at the beginning. And we talked about that a little bit. Supplemental water as needed. If you find that we haven't, you guys are lucky because you guys have actual decent rain in September in that insurance area. But unfortunately, where I live in New Braunfels, every time it comes to New Braunfels, it does this. And so I have to supplement. But supplementing isn't a bad thing. Just don't overwater. Think about the rain itself. Rain will come maybe once a week. Maybe it's an inch, maybe it's not. Just get out there and make sure that the soil is moist. Full sun, of course, and drainage. So site preparation. Rake and till your surface. So you're going to level it out. It could be an inch deep. It doesn't have to be. But just enough so that when you put your seeds down, the seeds have something to grasp into at the beginning as they go. So prepping your soil. So we talked about raking and tilling. Even distributing. You can mix it with sand because that will allow your drainage. Sand in the soil will allow your drainage for your wildflowers. Wet and tap down. Again, we know how to plant seeds. We just go ahead and we lay them on top and then just pat them down lightly because you don't want to cover them too much because then you can actually just defeat the purpose of planting them together. And then planting in a pot. So here's what I heard, and I am trying this on my own. I went ahead and I planted my wildflower seeds, but I also saved a little bit back, and I planted them in a container. And this was a brilliant idea for me because I don't know which is a weed and which is not. And so by planting them in a container, it's a contained area that I will be able to see what's actually supposed to come up and what it looks like. And I had never heard that before, and this was kind of a wonderful brainstorm of planting a little bit off to the side, so when those seeds come up and those little blooms are coming, I know what I'm supposed to be pulling and what I'm not supposed to be pulling. And so that was like, wow, what a brilliant idea. So as you can see, you've got very similar leaf looks, but this is blue bonnet, this is dandelion. So again, if you want to keep your dandelions, you're more than welcome to do that. But if you don't want them to take over so that the blue bonnets can grow, just make sure you're pulling what you need to be pulling. So wildflower keep up. So you allow your wildflowers to finish blooming and set seed before you mow or take out or cut down. So again, that's really difficult when we all want our gardens to look beautiful all the time, right? They all want to look like this all year round. They're getting pretty. Not so much. By the time they're done, they're done. So in something like this, what you have to sit back and you have to realize is that the birds like it too. And then you have to be gardening for the birds. And let the birds take the seeds, let the birds and the bees come and do what they need to do, even though it may not be pretty. Mow to 3 to 6 inches so that you're not damaging perennials if you've planted perennials. with it, and you want to let it drop and let it back into the soil so the nutrients can give the seeds what they need. Don't fertilize. And I know that's hard for us because we want to give everything that we need to do, but you have to realize that the wildflowers, they allow and they make their own nutrients and will recycle on a regular basis. And then water only if it long droughts, because the rain is sufficient. Some seasons will be better. If you want a big season for your bluebonnets, then you're going to water on a more regular basis. If you want to just see what the world has to offer, then you just go ahead and let the rain, once you get them established and they start coming up, just let the rain do its thing. It'll make it happen.
Yeah, I have a lot of fun about that.
So we covered a lot. If you have any further questions, we'll be able to do that. I do want to touch on containers. Wildflowers are not necessarily a container crop. You want to have them in the dirt and have space. Because they need whatever nutrients are from the soil, but they also need whatever comes from the watering portion. Because when you water, remember, you're not watering just for then. You're watering for 2 or 3 days down the road. So by putting it in a container, you're restricting the ability of what that seed can do. So, like I said, we covered a lot. Covered about throwing them down. You can give it a shot. You're more than welcome to do that. But you want to make sure to give them the best success that they can possibly have in your area that you're doing. Site and location planning. Planning not only for the beauty in your spring, but you also want to plant for the beauty of 2 springs down the road. How long do you want those flowers there? How long do you want those plants there? Because they will be there for quite some time once you put them in the ground. Write down a journal. Pay attention to when you plant them. Pay attention to when you go ahead and harvest. So long, you can actually harvest those seeds and save them for October when you're ready to plant again. Planting, we talked about, watering and seeding, and then don't forget what zone you're in, because again, you can't pick these seeds and just plant them in Michigan or plant them in Ohio. You know, they are for the southern region, they are for zone 9 and 10. So take those into account. Pay attention, as always, to your frost date. I don't like getting out there and planting in the cold, so try to plan ahead and give them the best chance that they can. And then here are a couple of resources that we have, obviously. I can't hold this thing. Texas A&M Wildflower in Bloom, there's an Aggie Center of Wild Seeds. If you want to go ahead and go on there, there's a lot of information. And of course, Lady Bird Johnson's Wildflower Center. She has different classes, and if you're not part of the center, as far as being part of the Botanical Gardens, it's amazing. And even during the season, to go out and see what the flowers look like before you put them in your yard is super, super duper beneficial. I will tell you that they have a wildflower class on Sunday. I think this is Sunday coming up. There is a fee, but it's well worth its weight in gold to run out there. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. you put the seeds down, you tap them down, do you sprinkle or cover them in dirt at all, or do you?
You just go over them lightly. What I do is I actually water the dirt before I plant, and then I'll go out and I'll sprinkle my seeds down, and then just lightly tap them in, and let the water that's already there kind of take over. And then the next day, I do just a dusting of watering. You can get out there. There are people that get out there with their little spray bottles, and they will spray their area. I think I've taken on the wildflowers the way I like to garden, which is I'm pretty sporadic. And so I go out, I will water when I get out there and water. I will water just enough to let the water soak in. But I don't baby my wildflowers, because if you end up babying them, you're going to end up having to baby them all season, and I just don't. I like wildflowers for being wildflowers.
And did you have any problems with any pests or anything like spider mites or?
No. My pollinating, I will say this about my pollinating garden. My raised bed is literally, 50 feet from my pollinating garden. I have been blessed that everything is focused on the pollinating garden, that they've left my raised bed alone. Paul.
Yes. Asters were mentioned as being a good pollen pick for decorations. Is that for the whole family or just for that particular one?
Asters are good. I don't know enough about them to... I know enough about them to be dangerous, but I don't know enough about them to cut them off. I'm sorry. I wish I could give you a better answer. I don't have that research on the asters to, but I am going to find that out. And I will find somebody that knows if I don't know, and we'll make it happen for you. And that way you can take your flowers and put them on your kitchen counter. Yes.
In terms of collection and harvesting of wildflower seeds, do you necessarily need to break the entire
No. I would probably leave them, just make sure that they're dried out.
Okay.
And then just put them in a paper towel in a cool place and store them until your next venture. Because it's going to offer, when you put them in that way, it's going to offer the nutrients that it needs for those seeds that are actually coming up in the future.
Thanks, sir.
I have every year. Like you said, you have one that takes over more. This last year was the bluebonnets and the primrose, which I love my primrose. I just think they're a blessing. And they bring in the hummingbird moths. That's their number one flower, is the pink primrose. Yeah. And if you want to see me, I get out there right at dusk. I'll start zooming in. But I break all of your rules, but I seed as things die, and I do keep some seeds, because of course if you plant one seed and you get a plant that has 100 seeds on it, after a while you can't move anymore. So I keep some and throw the rest, because I found that in the past if you keep them, you have good intentions on going and getting them out there at whatever month.
Yeah.
So, but I have never, every year I have more stuff than I've had. So I do it as I'm out in the garden. I just rip off what I want and I throw it where I want it. And I don't water ever. my front yard is completely xeriscaped. It has no soil in it. It's all rocks and flower beds. And I just toss my seeds everywhere and forget about them. And your bluebonnets will come up. Like you can start seeing bluebonnets this month or next month. Mm-hmm. Do not freak out, because they might look tender, but they can survive every cold snap, ice, everything. They'll be right there. They're not going to die before February. They're just doing their thing.
Well, I think that's the love of the wildflowers, though, mm-hmm. is that you just let it do.
And embrace the ones you get instead of trying to fight the ones you didn't.
Yeah, amen, sister. You're preaching to the choir.
Yes, sir.
All I do is, once they're dead, I just lower down and.
There you go.
So my question is, I'm like, the lady who worked out some of my private work, okay. Because when I came, that's what I wanted, was still to leave on the track. But, and maybe it's because I'm putting them with other wildlife, like wine cups, do you know anything about them? Like, I grew up seeing those everywhere, and now it's kind of like I don't see them, and I want them, and I plant them, and I.
Yeah, there was a lady at the naturalist group, and she loves wine cups as well.
Yeah.
But she's had a struggle, she had that, that beautiful field, they made a whole field, and they did all wildflowers, and she loves wine cups, but it's taken about 2 or 3 years for her to get just in a specific area.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know nothing about that.
That's fine.
I try to, and honestly, in my class, I try to teach people about things that they can be successful with right away. And so that's why I do blue bonnets and Indian paintbrushes and the blankets, is because those are things that you can be successful with per season. If you get into more of the details of the wildflowers and all of the different ones that are out there to offer, some take a little bit more work and a lot more care and stuff that I'm not willing to give. But I want you to be successful right off the bat. And so I'll give you the easy peasies, and then you can go and venture on. And that's why I gave you guys the bingo card. So as you're going into the spring, keep it on your refrigerator, and as you see things out and about, just breeze through and see if you can, play bingo with yourself on your refrigerator and notice what you see out there. And like I said, I get nothing from American Seed, but they're live and local, and they're easy to get to. They don't have a garden out there, they don't have anything like that, but they're incredibly knowledgeable, and they are more than happy to sit and talk with you for a few minutes.
American Seed has a lot of grasses also.
Uh-huh, they have grasses and all of that good stuff too, so if you've got that area that you don't know quite what to do with, they'll be doing that. I don't get anything from them, but